I'm Ronnie Allen. Following are portions of an interview that I did with Roy Orbison in 1975 while working for Casey Kasem and American Top 40.
We were playing for a dance on New Year's Eve, and they wanted to hear Shake, Rattle, and Roll. Knew a little of it, so we started 12 midnight. The clock on the wall didn't say what my watch said, so we had to play it for about 10 minutes. By the time it was through, I was converted. So we went for a strong backbeat. So anyway, then from the television shows and everything in 55 and 6, the early spring of 56, we went to Sun Records.
This is you and your group?
Yes. And signed with Sam Phillips.
Was Elvis still with Sun Records at the time?
Elvis had just left. I asked Sam why he let Elvis go. And he said, for $40,000 in Carl Perkins. That didn't make a lot of sense to me. But what he meant to say was that he had Carl Perkins. He sold Elvis for $40,000. So.
Well, in those days, though, $40,000 was...
It was a ton of money. It certainly was.
Yep. So you came over to Sun. You auditioned for Sam Phillips, right?
Yes, we did. I actually cut the demo at Norman Petty's studio in Clovis, New Mexico, because it was handy to wink, and sent that to him, and he said, come on down and we'll record. So I did that for a couple of years. The first hit record was Ooby Dooby, which was the very first record.
Hey, baby, jump over here when you do the Ooby Dooby. I just ought to be near Ooby Dooby.
That hit the charts on June 6th of 1956.
Yes, it did.
And it got to 59 in the country. Sun 242.
Yes, it was.
Well, I guess a copy of that is fairly rare these days, isn't it?
Yes, they go for about $400 in England.
Must go for a pretty penny here, too.
Yeah, I think they're very, very rare. The 78s are. We actually put out 78.
It scarcely foreshadowed what was to come. I mean, obviously...
There was no glimmering.
Must have come out around the time of Blue Suede Shoes.
Yes, I started touring with Carl and Johnny, and Jerry Lee came after that.
Had you, up until that point, ever met Elvis Presley?
Well, we did a tour in June or July, and when I got to Memphis on this tour, Ooby Dooby was number one in Memphis, and Elvis came to Overton Park just to wave at the fans. And so we had our first conversation there, but then we did start bumming around together a little bit.
Your early records were, I guess, at least some of them were heavily influenced by Elvis.
When we all went in, I'd say with the exception of Johnny, but when I went in and Carl and Elvis, Sam would bring out these records of That's All Right by Arthur Crudup and Mystery Train and things like that that he had been recording. And he said, sing like that. We could take that any way we wanted it. What he meant to say was, I'm sure, sing with soul, although the word hadn't been invented, so he meant sing with feeling.
Now, how did this affect college? Were you still going to college at the time?
I dropped out for that tour at the end of the second year. I took the test to finish the credits for 2 full years. I got the offer of that tour.
Did you have any idea what you were going to do with your life when you went to college and majored in history and English?
Well, I was going to, as soon as the college thing was done, I was going right into music, and then if I didn't make it, fall back on the college. I saw right away that that was the wrong psychology. If you have something to fall back on, you usually do. So I just cut the tie that binds and took off and left that altogether.
You had a few records after that on Sun, didn't you, after Ooby Dooby?
Yes, I had two, if memory serves, two more records, and then I became disenchanted with Sun Records. Just stopped recording or doing anything really actively until I wrote the song Claudette.
Claudette was about your wife. Were you married to her at the time that you wrote that?
Yes, in 57. So I wrote the song more or less in late 57, and I showed it to the Everly Brothers early 58.
Did you write it for the Everly Brothers?
No, I wrote it and took it by Sun Records. In fact, put it down just with me and my voice. And that track has been released by Shelby Singleton, I think, on the Sun. Anything that I went in and did, if it was a demo or whatever.
Well, well, hey, hey, yeah, I got a brand new baby and I feel so good. She loves me even better than I thought she would. I'm on my way to her house and I'm blown out of breath. When I see her tonight, I'm gonna squeeze her to death. Claudette, pretty little pet, Claudette, never make me fret, Claudette. She's the sweetest little girl that I ever met. I got the best love that I'll ever get from Claudette.
the Everlys did it, it was the flip side of All I Have to Do Is Dream.
Yes, it was in the States. Around the world, it was the A side.
Oh, oh, Claudette. Oh, oh, Claudette. I got a brand new baby and I feel so good. She loves me even better than I thought she would. I'm on my way to her house and I'm full out of breath. But when I see her tonight, I'm gonna squeeze her to death. Claudette, pretty little fair Claudette, never make me fret, Claudette.
Had you written any other songs in the period, let's say, between Sun and Monument? Were you doing anything else besides having written that song?
A couple of songs for Buddy Holly, which were An Empty Cup.
One lonely night.
One lonely night.
At this drive-in.
At this drive-in.
And now I know.
And now I know.
What a fool I've been.
What a fool I've been.
She was to meet
me. An empty cup, a broken day.
We had a day.
A broken day.
And You've Got Love.
You got two lips that look so fine. You got one heart I wish was mine. Love, sweet love, you got love,
genuine love.
You got two arms that you could...
Were those album cuts?
Yes, Buddy made two albums, one Buddy Holly and one the Crickets. Both teams were on one of them.
Did you know Buddy quite well?
Yes, Yeah, we only lived 90 miles apart, so when he had a hit, I would go see his show, and when I had one, he would come to my show.
When you auditioned for Sam Phillips, was that the first record company that you actually tried for?
Yes, it was. It was the first shot out.
Now, after you left Sun, you did not immediately seek another record label, did you?
Well, we actually did. I actually quit Sun in 57, but I didn't officially leave until 58. Now, we went to RCA. What happened was, with the money from Sun, Claudette, and Down the Line, which Jerry Lee did.
Did you write that?
Yes.
I'm gonna get some real gonna love, it'll drive a cool cat a while. Gonna move on down the line. Gonna get me a gal, then I'll go out on the town. Well, the move on down the line, I'm gonna get me a gal, make some time, you're gonna be deep sweat, you're getting me slow, but when you start to struggle, we gotta go. I'm gonna move.
So those came out at the same time and made me enough money to move to Nashville. I made two records with RCA.
Right.
Sweet and Innocent was the first one. Like a clown, 'cause I think I found the cream of the crop. I know I'll never... Ted was having his problems with the hierarchy, with the people above him. He couldn't release what he wanted to when he wanted to. I had since moved back to Texas, having spent most of the money I made. Well, my manager, Wesley Rose, called me and asked me would I like to be on Monument Records. And I said, well, I'll come in and talk about it. So I came into town, and my accountant said, you're late for your session.
They already had it all planned?
All set up. So I jumped in the station wagon, we raced over and recorded the song. And that's the way I met Fred Foster in Monument Records.
Now, was that song Uptown?
No, that was a song called With the Bug.
Well, I'm down through the age of woman to have a time, trying to get a man who walks the chalk line, to keep him on his string with a kiss and a hug. But there never been a man that wasn't bitten by the bug. And a rockin' and a rollin' with a bug, a rollin' and a strollin' with a bug, itchin' and a twitchin', a singin' and a swingin', a yeah, with a bug. Oh, well, Delilah, Lord, if anybody wouldn't stay home.
And Paperboy.
I walk down to the blue side of town, where there's no happiness, no joy. Down at the end of a long dark street, I saw a little paper boy.
Paper boy, paper boy,
I've got bad news for you.
Paper boy, paper boy,
me and my baby are through.
That came before Uptown.
Yes. Thing was, it was released, but it wasn't. And then to explain that, I would say that it was, we issued DJ copies and things, but by that time we had written Uptown, come to Nashville and recorded it, and it was so superior, we jumped on top of the other record.
That you've ever seen. Oh. Uptown, just my baby and me.
Set up Only the Lonely, I think.
It sure did. As I recall, Only the Lonely, I remember Frank Sinatra had a best-selling album called Only the Lonely, but certainly the title, the expression Only the Lonely was a popular expression, and when you did it in your song, of course, the timing was right and everything, and it just came out at the right time, and that's the one that established you, really.
Yeah, what happened on that was that it wasn't something we lifted or anything. When I say we, there was myself and Joe Mills. I met Joe in 59, and he wrote a pretty good song, and I wrote a pretty good song, so we thought together we could write a great one. And we were writing on this song, and it started out with one title. We called Fred Foster, and he said, no, that won't work. We changed the title again, and he said, that won't work.
Do you remember what the original title
was? The original title was Cry.
Now, there had been a big hit called Cry.
Exactly, and so that was Fred's thinking, and we changed it to Why.
And there had been a big hit called Why.
Exactly right, and then we changed it to Young Lovers, and Pat Boone came out with the song at that exact
Welcome
same.
Young Lovers.
Yeah. And so one evening we were sitting around, and Only the Lonely hit me right between the eyes. And I called Fred and I said, we've got the title, and we don't care whether you like it or anybody else likes it, it's going to stay like it is.
But you had to rewrite the lyrics, didn't you, then?
And not a great deal. You had to write a couple of verses, just the basic idea.
Dum, 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 dum.
Only the lonely,
dum 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 dum
it's really kind of funny because you hear Only the Lonely, and at this point, if you had told me that, I would have never dreamt, because it almost sounds like it couldn't possibly have been anything else other than Only the Lonely, because it fits so good. That was a follow-up to Uptown.
Yes.
It must have sold over a million copies, didn't it?
Yes, it was a couple of million.
A couple of million.
The reason I say that is because it was then that I and most of our people realized the potential, which a lot of people didn't realize, that there was a domestic market and a foreign market. And we did about a million here and a million worldwide.
Well, a million here, a million there, doesn't hurt.
That started us into this whole thing of playing domestically or foreign. After the Beatles, then it really became something big.
But in fact, some of your records, you had some smashes in England that never even got heard here.
Right, and vice versa.
And vice versa, right. That's the way it goes. Now, Only the Lonely was a smash. You followed it up with Blue Angel. Now, you co-wrote Only the Lonely.
Yes.
And what about Uptown? Did you write that yourself? Or?
No, Joe Melson and I wrote the Uptown, Only the Lonely, and Blue Angel.
Then you had a thing called I'm Hurtin'.
Yeah.
Did you co-write that too?
Yeah.
Running Scared was the first one to hit number one in Billboard. Is there a story behind Running Scared?
Only that when I was with Sun Records, the first record was a hit, the second one wasn't, the third was a complete bomb. Only the Lonely sold 2 million, Blue Angel 1 million, I'm Hurtin' about 600,000. And I said, here we go again, on the way out. And then we came up with Running Scared in about 40 minutes, Joe and I.
Did you just sit down and say, we're going to write another hit, or we're going to try to write something?
No, we wrote 4 songs, and that was one of them. So, and just straight to number one.
Just running scared, each place we go, so afraid that he might show. Yeah, running scared, what would
initially, you had been influenced by Presley. I think you were starting really to develop your own style by this point.
We were actually initially knocked out by the black artists who were really putting it on. And people like Joe Turner, for one. The Platters just goes on and on, really. Little Richard. So the beat music and Boney Maroney and all that stuff really got to us. But see, essentially, I wanted to be a ballad singer all along.
Even in the Oobie Doobie days?
even in the oogadoo.
When you say a ballad singer, did you think in terms of a Tony Bennett ballad singer, or
no,
did you think
a beat ballad, something with some substance to it, you know?
I'm trying to determine what was your first one. Scared with a beat ballad.
Crying followed that. It was also a beat ballad in the fact that it was a big thing, you know, it grew.
Did you co-write Crying with Joe?
Yes.
I was all right for a while. I could smile for a while. But I saw you last night. You held my hand so tight as you stopped to say hello. Oh, you wished me well. You couldn't tell that I've been crying.
About Candyman, that was the flip side.
Candyman was sent to us out of New York, and we sort of did our own interpretation. It was sent in a la What I Say, so we slowed it down.
That was your first two-sided hit.
Yes, it was.
You had one other two-sided hit, which was Leah and Working for the Man.
Yes, uh-huh.
Working for the man.
I always liked the song, Lee. It was a pretty song, but it was not one of your bigger hits, actually.
No, it has since come to be, but it wasn't at the time.
You get a lot of requests for that in concert?
Oh, yes. One of the biggest things we do, but at the time, it wasn't that well received.
It was a split play, of course.
Right.
Which didn't help too much.
It didn't really help.
It was Working for the Man broke first, actually, yes. And then they began playing the other.
There was one of the two sides of it. It was Mean Woman Blues and Blue Bike.
Oh, yeah. I'm sorry. That's right. I don't want to leave out any.
Well, I got a woman mean as she can be. Well, I got a woman mean as she can be. Now, sometimes I think she's almost mean as me. She got a ruby lip, she got shapely hips, yeah. Boy, she makes a royal deal. But I got a woman mean as she can be. I feel so bad, I've got a worried mind. I'm so lonesome all the time. Since I left my baby behind on Blue Bayou, I'll never be blue, my dreams come true on Blue Bayou.
In fact, that last one was bigger than Leah and Work for the Man. Okay, now you had a string of hits. You were constantly on the chart for a period from the beginning of 1960, I guess, starting with Uptown, and really starting with Only the Lonely, you know, in terms of strength, up until, I guess, 65.
Right.
In fact, you even had hits beyond the beginning of the Beatle period, which is something that a lot of American artists could not even do, because it seemed that it was almost impossible to get played once the British music started to break.
The thing was, I never toot my own horn, but
right.
Anyway, the year that the Beatles were the number one vocal group, I was the number one male artist in the world. So they didn't affect me.
You certainly had one of the biggest records of your career with a thing called Oh Pretty Woman.
Yes, right in the middle of the Beatlemania.
And I've always wondered why that was called Oh Pretty Woman, when I think you're saying Pretty Woman more times in the song than Oh Pretty Woman.
Yes. That came about because I didn't know it, but we had written a song called Pretty Woman earlier, Joe and I had. It was an altogether different thing, but after Crying and then Working for the Man and Leah, I wrote by myself because I was touring a lot, and so Joe wasn't writing with me anymore. And then I wrote In Dreams.
By yourself?
Yes.
A candy-colored clown they call the Sandman tiptoes to my room every night, just to sprinkle stardust and to whisper, go to sleep, everything is all right. I close my eyes, then I drift away into the magic night. I softly say a silent prayer.
And then I met a fellow named Bill Dees. We wrote Pretty Woman.